All right, so American history is a litany of lies about black people. One of the most egregious lies is that slavery's end opened the door to equality and freedom. But we still hear the knock of oppression today. We still feel the impact of slavery, of Jim Crow, of mass incarceration, and deplorable economic injustices. No matter how many lectures we get about pulling ourselves up by our bootstraps, we know the truth. There is a debt to be paid. I'm Jay from Push Black, and today on Black History Year, we're digging into how it might look for black folks to finally receive what we're due. Today, we're talking about reparations. Leading the way is the economist Dr. William Darity. He's put in the work to fully understand every aspect of reparations and all the arguments for and against it. Let's dig in. All right, Dr. Darity, thanks for joining us on Black History Year. Glad to have been introduced to you, and thank you for making the time to speak with us. How are you today?
I'm fine. Thanks for having me on your program.
Absolutely, absolutely. I've been following your work for a couple years now, and I really appreciate what you've been doing and sharing. And I just felt like more of our audience, Push Black's audience, needed to hear it. So I'd love to get into it. Could you just start by telling us who you are and what you do?
So I'm a professor at Duke University, and I'm also the director of the Samuel Du Bois Cook Center on Social Equity. And I would describe most of my research as being focused on the area of stratification economics, but most recently doing a continued intense dive into the question of reparations for Black American descendants of U.S. slavery. And that's resulted in a newly published book that I've co-authored with Kirsten Mullen that's called From Here to Equality, Reparations for Black Americans in the 21st Century.
I'd like to start with a question that we ask every guest. What does Black liberation look like to you?
Black liberation looks to me like the establishment of the conditions for full citizenship for Black Americans in the United States so that we can engage in the political process in such a way that we can transform the direction that American politics takes with respect to marginalized people in the United States, but throughout the world.
A lot of your work is in reparations, but that wasn't always the case, right?
No, that wasn't always the case. In fact, I started out as a reparation skeptic. This is about 30 years ago when I was asked to write an introduction to a volume that later was called The Wealth of Races, which was edited by Richard America. And Richard approached me about writing the introduction to this volume. And my response at the time was, really? I mean, there's no chance that reparations is ever going to become a reality in the United States. So why are we wasting our time doing this? I want to be clear. I never thought that reparations was something that wasn't justified on moral grounds, but I simply thought that it was something that was wholly impractical and unlikely to occur on political grounds. So that's what I said to Richard at the time, and his response was he wanted me to write the introduction, and I could say whatever I wanted to say. I could even say that this was a silly exercise in this volume. But as I read the essays, which were a series of essays in which economists were estimating what the magnitude of a reparations bill should be, as I read them, I became increasingly convinced that the scope and magnitude of the harms that had been inflicted on Black Americans were so great that the only true solution or the only true way in which we could heal the wounds of those damages was by a project that we would call a reparations plan. And then I came to say to myself that even if this was something that had very low odds of becoming a reality, then it was something that I did have to commit myself to working toward. So sometimes you have to make a decision to pursue something, even if you may think that it's really very unlikely for it to take place, if it's the right thing to do. And that was the decision I reached around 1989, the latter part of 1989. And subsequently, I've worked on reparations as a serious research endeavor, but also I've been an advocate of reparations.
When you first started, was there any pushback from your colleagues or peers? Like, were you tenured at this point? Like, what was that like saying, okay, now I'm going to focus on reparations for you professionally and personally?
So I was fortunate insofar as I received tenure fairly early in my career as an academic. I finished MIT in 1978, and I was a tenured associate professor by the fall semester of 1981.
Wow.
And so the question of career jeopardy because of the lack of tenure was not something that I've had to worry about. So I've been very fortunate in that respect. However, there are other ways in which slings and arrows can come your way. And this is in terms of the degree of recognition you get from your peers, the way in which your work might be valued. And I'll have to say that the work that I did on reparations really was largely ignored by others in the economics profession until maybe the past 2 years or so. And so I've never tended to try to do the research that I think is important to do with an expectation that it would necessarily result in some immediate or direct benefit. I also have done work, you know, with the assumption that maybe it will not be something that will stir the waters at all. But there is a value, I think, in putting bread on the water, because at some point, maybe somebody will pick it up. So I've been very stunned over the past couple of years, that the degree of attention that some of the policy ideas that I have been working on for a long time have suddenly gained, and it's been gratifying.
Let's define reparations for our audience, and then I'd love for you to share why you think there's been increased attention around this idea the past few years.
So the general definition of reparations that Kirsten and I offer in From Here to Equality is a program of acknowledgement, redress, and closure for a grievous injustice. So that's a general definition. It's not necessarily specific to reparations for Black American descendants of U.S. slavery. And the premise here is that there are three components to reparations. The first is acknowledgement, which is the recognition on the part of the culpable party that they have committed atrocities, and that simultaneously they agree that they must address those atrocities in some way. And so addressing the atrocities is the second component of reparations. It's the act of redress. And historically, in many cases in the 20th century, where reparations have been provided to victimized communities, redresses involve direct monetary payments to the victims. But, you know, you could conceive of alternatives, but I think that the norm has largely been making direct monetary payments to the victims. The third component is closure, which means that the culpable party and the victimized community reach an agreement that the debt has been paid, that the bill has been met, and there will be no further claims made by the victimized community on the culpable party unless there's a renewal of past atrocities or there's a new wave of a different type of atrocities that takes place.
Can you walk us through the history of where this idea for reparations started as far as Black folks are concerned? Because you're following the tradition of others who have spoke on it and fought for it and researched it. So can you take us from the beginning of how this conversation started in the grand scheme of things?
Well, absolutely. It's got a long history.
Yeah.
Certainly, I'm hardly the first person to talk about this. And in my lifetime, I would argue that someone like Mary Frances Berry, the historian who did a study on Callie House, who I'll mention in a moment, is probably the person with one of the longest running research interests in the phenomenon of reparations. But yeah, I think that the question of reparations comes into play before slavery ends, and that there is a number of actors in the abolition movement, both Black and white, who start talking about the idea that restitution should be made to the folks who have suffered under the yoke of slavery once slavery comes to an end. And immediately after the Civil War, of course, there was a plan for restitution. It was the provision of 40-acre land grants to the formerly enslaved that was supposed to constitute an act of redress. And unfortunately, even though there was a start to that process, I think initially about 400,000 acres of land were allocated to about 40,000 of the formerly enslaved. And that's 40,000 people out of 4 million. Even that allocation was taken back from them as a consequence of the decision that was made by President Andrew Johnson to revoke efforts to institutionalize full citizenship for Black Americans. And so that's the stage at which reparations was under serious consideration, and the project was started, but it was never completed and it was not fulfilled. Subsequent to that, the major reparations initiative is the one that I mentioned that was led by a woman named Callie House. She made her living by taking in laundry, cleaning it. And so she was very much a person who came from the grassroots. She was not at all part of the Black elite of the time. And she was highly successful. She was able to generate a petition that had 300,000 signatures from the formerly enslaved. And this petition was intended to get them pensions from the United States government. Well, apparently this wasn't something that was a source of great enthusiasm in American officialdom. She also had significant pushback from the Black elite as well. And the net result was that she was subjected to mail fraud charges, and she was brought down by those charges and actually had to spend some time in prison as a consequence. But that basically gutted her efforts to try to obtain pensions for the formerly enslaved. Now, it's interesting to note that her followers move into the Garvey movement. And this is an important finding in Mary Frances Berry's study on Callie House, which is called My Face is Black is True, that her followers move into the Garvey movement, which becomes an arm of advocacy for reparations as well. And it's, of course, noteworthy that the way in which they brought Garvey down was also through mail fraud.
Yeah.
So then some of Garvey's followers attached themselves to the efforts of Queen Mother Audley Moore, who actually brought a case before the United Nations for reparations for Black Americans. But again, this was an effort that didn't really result in an outcome that was associated with the actual act of redress by the United States government. And I believe it's Queen Mother Audley Moore's followers who flow into the organization in COBRA, the National Coalition on Black Reparations in America. And then NCOBRA plays an important role in keeping the story of reparations alive and also in introducing legislation that I'm very critical of in the present moment, but it's not insignificant legislation to introduce a commission to study reparations and to provide proposals to Congress for legislation for reparations, notably now referred to as H.R. 40, which is a nod to the unfulfilled promise of the 40 acres. And then around the year 2000, there was a lot of attention or stir about reparations on college campuses, where we found a situation in which an individual who was hostile towards reparations placed an advertisement in a number of university newspapers attacking reparations, saying 10 reasons why it's a bad idea. And that seemed to have actually had the effect of stimulating more conversation about it on college campuses and more attention, to the point where my understanding is that in the year 2001, Jesse Jackson was on the verge of putting forward a major effort or building a major effort around reparations. But unfortunately, this occurred at around exactly the same time as the 9/11 attacks. And folks who have studied the history of reparations say that when those terrorist attacks occurred, the nation's attention was drawn so fully to that it actually erased the kind of momentum that was building for a serious national conversation about reparations. And so things go silent from my standpoint, largely, until Ta-Nehisi Coates' essay that's put in the Atlantic in 2014 called The Case for Reparations. And that creates some ferment. But again, it's not permanent. And I think that the latest wave of excitement or interest about reparations also coincides with the emergence, primarily through social media, of a movement that we now call American descendants of slavery, or ADOs. So that's kind of my sense of the trajectory of the reparations movement from slavery to the present moment. I think what's really unique about the year 2019 is, for the first time in my lifetime, we heard credible candidates for the presidency actually utter the word reparations or be questioned about reparations for Black Americans. And to the best of my knowledge, that hasn't happened before in my lifetime, and probably not to that degree since the Reconstruction era.
And I'm interested in your just opinion on why now? Why do you think there's more interest now from our people and from other people as well?
Well, and you know, I mentioned the ADOS movement having a significant effect in Black Twitter world.
Yeah.
So I think that that stimulated a substantial amount of interest. I think that the fact that not only have, you know, Black folks for years have been concerned about anti-Black police violence, but it's only in the current year, in the midst of the coronavirus epidemic, that we have a situation in which actually some significant numbers of white Americans and other people around the world are recognizing the degree of viciousness that's associated with the way in which the American police treat Black people. And I think that that's triggered additional attention to the reparations effort. Maybe the last thing I can mention, and this is all speculation on my part, is the intense racism, overt racism that's expressed by the Trump administration. And so I think that that has had a pushback effect, which has led to people thinking in a very serious way about very, very dramatic and bold policy alternatives to the direction that the country is currently taking.
Let's define the victims of these atrocities as far as Black folks go. How do you define that?
Well, in the context of our work, we talk about three phases of injustice, racial injustice in the United States, that has affected a particular segment of the Black population. Now, to be frank, it's the vast majority of the Black population in the United States, probably 90% of Black Americans, upwards of 40 million people who would fit into this category that we're describing. But the three phases of racial injustice start with slavery. I think it's important to note that when we talk about reparations or African-American reparations, we are not just talking about so-called slavery reparations, although slavery is critical to the narrative that we unfold. But that's the first phase. The second phase actually took place longer in the history of the United States as a republic, which was nearly a century of legal segregation in the United States. And this was a period in which not only was segregation imposed in the United States, but also there were substantial waves of white mob violence that resulted in the destruction of Black property, or in many cases, the appropriation of Black property by the mobsters, as well as a tremendous level of loss of Black lives. So, you know, when people talk about Black Lives Matter, that's an important statement relative to the entire historical trajectory in the United States. And so that's the second phase, is the Jim Crow period, or the period of legal segregation. And then the third is the post-Civil Rights Act era, in which we have ongoing mass incarceration. We have police executions of unarmed Blacks. We have ongoing discrimination in employment, credit, and housing. And most significant from the standpoint of what we set as the target for what African-American reparations should achieve is the enormous gap in wealth between Blacks and whites in the United States. And we view this gap in wealth as the prime indicator of the cumulative intergenerational effects of white supremacy in the United States. And the magnitude of that gap is enormous. Black Americans who are descendants of U.S. chattel slavery constitute about 13% of the nation's population, but possess only 2.5% of the nation's wealth. That translates into a situation where, on average, the mean Black household has $800,000 less in net worth than the mean white household. And we estimate in From Here to Equality that if you were going to eliminate or erase that differential in wealth, it would require somewhere in the vicinity of $10 to $12 trillion. Roughly $250,000 to $300,000 per person.
I think people try to come up with ways around direct payments. I think when candidates were vying for the Democratic nomination, they were coming up with creative solutions, but no one was saying direct payments of any kind. Why do you advocate for direct payments?
The direct payments would give individual recipients maximum discretion over the use of the funds. And I think that that's critical. In other cases of reparations in the modern era, direct payments have been made to the recipients, and they have had full authority over how the funds are going to be used. They never got any directives about how they might spend the money. And I'm thinking in particular about the German government's payments to victims of the Holocaust. I'm thinking about the U.S. government's payments to Japanese Americans who were unjustly incarcerated during the course of World War II. I'm also thinking about American payments that were made to families who lost loved ones in the course of the 9/11 terrorist attacks. And interestingly enough, that's an instance in which the U.S. government made payments, although it was not responsible for the terrorist attacks itself. But in all those cases, the individual recipients received varying sums of money, quite substantial sums in the case of some of the families that lost loved ones in the course of the 9/11 attacks, and there were no strings attached. And so I think that it's an apt parallel for how a reparations project should be executed for Black Americans. But the other reason is that some of these indirect approaches to the provision of reparations, like community level or neighborhood level programs and the like, I think are imprecise in terms of who actually receives the funds. For example, in the midst of rapid gentrification, I think it becomes very, very problematic to try to conduct reparations by making neighborhood or community level grants for the purposes of trying to address the inequalities that we observe.
So there's definitely resistance. There's always been resistance to this idea. And do you think that is all based in racism, or is it bad for the American economy? What are your opinions on the resistance in the present day?
The question I always have when people are resistant to the idea of reparations, and usually now people don't say they're resistant to it on moral or ethical grounds. I mean, there are some people who still say that, but most people don't say that. They talk instead about a host of logistical barriers to doing it. So it's not so much a question of whether or not it's the right thing to do. It's more of a question of whether or not it's actually feasible to do it. And so I think one of the central themes of our book, particularly the final chapter, chapter 13, it's devoted to sketching how you might actually execute a reparations program. And we invest a significant amount of time in the book trying to address the standard kinds of logistical complaints that people make about reparations. So one of them is, as you point out, people always ask, how will you pay for it? Well, they always ask that about any kind of transformative policy that could be considered in the United States. And so it's actually a knee-jerk question that's used as an obstruction method. And I'm not sure that it's ever really asked in good faith. But our response is that if you just pay close attention to the ways in which the United States government has responded to the current crisis and the ways in which it responded to the Great Recession, it becomes transparent that the federal government has a tremendous capacity to spend enormous sums of money without actually raising anybody's taxes. Mm. And so I think the question of how will you pay for it should be taken off the table in light of our experiences during the course of the Great Recession and our experiences most recently. The CARES Act was enacted without any increase in taxes, but a significant increase in federal expenditures. So we would argue that you could do the same thing to finance a reparations project. We even suggest in the book that you could space the payments over the course of approximately a decade. We suggest that the racial wealth gap has to be eliminated within 10 years, but you could space the payments over the course of a decade if you're really nervous about making a substantial expenditure all at one time. But from our perspective, what is really critical in terms of understanding what the limits are to government spending is the inflation risk. And that's something that we say must be considered in any new expenditure effort. And a new expenditure effort has to be designed in such a way that it minimizes the likelihood that there'll be some significant amount of inflation. But that's the only barrier. The federal government does not face a constraint on its spending based upon its tax revenue. State and local governments do, but not the federal government, because it's the issuer of a sovereign currency.
Could you break down how what you're talking about with reparations is different than a program to end poverty?
Well, reparations is not an anti-poverty program. And poverty programs focus on people's income rather than on their wealth position. And the distinction is important. You know, income is a flow of resources that for most people is largely associated with their annual earnings. In contrast, wealth is the difference between the value of what you own and what you owe. So it's the net value of your personal property. It's the difference between your assets and your liabilities. And wealth is critical because it actually can provide you with resources to negotiate times in which you suffer significant income losses. So, for example, a family with a strong wealth position can weather the storm of the loss of a job by their breadwinners. It can weather the storm of a catastrophic illness that requires significant expenditures of funds for medical care. It can much more easily purchase health insurance in the first place, so that it would be protected or insulated from the cost associated with a catastrophic illness. A wealthier family can buy its way into a home that has greater likelihood of appreciation, a home that's located in a neighborhood with high amenities, a home that's located in a neighborhood with a quality school for their children. And if they're still not satisfied with the school that's available in their neighborhood, if they're wealthy, they can purchase private education. Wealthier families can provide their sons and daughters with a college education that is debt-free. They can engage more effectively in the political process because money really talks in American politics. And of course, they can transfer resources to subsequent generations to try to ensure that they have greater odds of having economic security and economic well-being.
Let's talk about wealth a little more. Let's see. So say reparations did happen. How could we as a community prepare ourselves for that type of situation? What type of institutions or processes will we need in place? What kind of thinking will we need to have so we can maintain that wealth and pass it down to generations?
You know, if we're really concerned about the issue of trying to manage the way people spend their money, which is paternalistic from my standpoint, we don't have to make the outlays take the form of cash transfers, but we could make the direct payments in other forms, like the provision of a trust account, like the provision of an endowment, where there are some constraints or limitations on the speed in which you can draw down the funds. So that's a way in which, you know, if we're really concerned that people are going to do something wacky with the money, then we can take that kind of step in terms of the design of the allocation of the direct payments. So, you know, I've always been inclined to say that financial literacy without any finances is a waste of time. There's a great analogy that one of the people who was interviewing me recently offered. He said it's like giving people a recipe without any food. So if you were to provide reparations payments of the magnitude that I've been talking about, then people would have a significant amount of finances that would need to manage. And so you could institute resources for them to get some kind of training about how best to make use of their newfound wealth. We sometimes call that pre-reparations preparation.
I've seen some counterarguments against reparations about it, you know, not being the U.S. government's responsibility. I saw someone talking about the fact that, hey, the government went to war to end slavery. We've already done what we need to do for slavery. Like, what do you say to that type of argument?
And this is the argument that the debt has been paid because there was such a significant loss of life in the process of ending slavery. So I think in the course of the Civil War, approximately 700,000 people lost their lives. But we have to recognize that close to half of those were fighting to preserve slavery. So, you know, our focus on this notion of a debt because of lives lost has to be devoted exclusively to the Union side. And I've got another number of responses to that. The first response comes out of the use of a quotation from Malcolm X, where he talks about somebody plunging a knife in his back 9 inches. And he distinguishes between pulling the knife out and healing the wound. So I would argue that ending slavery was pulling the knife out, but healing the wound requires restitution to the folks who were subjected to the long years of bondage. Ending a harm is not the equivalent of compensating for the damages of the harm. So I think this is a specious argument on those grounds. But in addition, two other points, the Civil War didn't actually have to take place for slavery to end. In the fifth chapter of our book, we talk at length about efforts on the part of Abraham Lincoln and other representatives of the Republican Party to try to persuade Southern slaveholders to agree to a plan of compensated emancipation, which would have been a situation in which the federal government would have paid them for each person that they owned and paid them so that they would emancipate those individuals. And if we had had a scheme of compensated emancipation that had been exercised on a national scale, there would have been no reason to have a civil war for the purposes of ending slavery. So I think that, you know, for folks who are talking about this in this way, they have to recognize the fundamental guilt of the Confederate traitors in refusing to agree to a scheme of compensated emancipation. And then the final point I'd like to make is a significant number of the Union deaths were actually deaths of the formerly enslaved who were fighting for their own liberation on the Union side. And in fact, their death rate was higher than the death rate of the white Union soldiers. And their presence in the Union Army actually salvaged the manpower issues that the Union Army was being confronted with in the latter 2 years of the war, when there were significant numbers of whites in the North who were refusing to be conscripted or who were leaving the Union side, even though they were already under arms. It's actually a really bizarre notion to argue that the loss of lives that were associated with ending a harm constitutes compensation for the harm.
Just speaking of the loss of lives and what Black folks have sacrificed fighting against slavery and during slavery, there is this argument out there that it's like the people who actually deserve reparations are, you know, long gone, they're dead. But your plan is three-pronged, starting with slavery, then Jim Crow, and then the post-civil rights era.
Living descendants of persons who were enslaved in the United States, Black living descendants, are the folks who have to bear the burden of the cumulative effects of all of those phases of American history. I would add, of course, that had the formerly enslaved actually received restitution at the end of the Civil War, then we might not be having this conversation at all. In fact, they were not given restitution at the same time that significant numbers of white Americans received 160-acre land grants in the western part of the United States, under the dictates of the Homestead Act, for the purposes of engaging in settler colonialism. So on the one hand, you had whites receiving substantial allotments of land, handouts, if you will, while Black Americans received absolutely nothing for the years of bondage. And I think that's the beginning of the racial wealth gap in the United States that we observe today. And my argument is that the gap or differential that we observe today is a consequence of policies that were pursued by the federal government that resulted in the accumulation and stabilization of wealth among white Americans and the deprivation and denial of wealth for Black Americans.
And so when is it going to be too late? Because obviously there's arguments that slavery is a long time ago. Soon there will be folks that say, you know, Jim Crow, segregation was a long time ago. There won't be anybody to speak on it if it doesn't happen soon. So how late is too late for us to put pressure to get this achieved?
Well, to the extent that the dead hand of history is not really dead and it affects the lives of those who are living, I don't think we'll ever reach a point where we can ignore this without actually having to pay the debt. Now, I was born before Jim Crow ended. Both my wife and I spent the first 10 to 12 years of our lives under legal segregation in the United States. I think a lot of younger people don't really realize that there's a significant number of us who are still around for the moment who actually experienced Jim Crow directly. But, you know, of course, as you say, if they wait long enough, we'll be dead too. But one of the things we say in our book is a national act of procrastination does not absolve the nation of having to meet the debt.
Powerful. All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Darity, for speaking with me today on Black History Year. You've offered some amazing information, and I hope folks get everything we need to get from it. To think about this critically and take action. You know, I know there's a lot of our folks out there that are still just against this idea as a concept, so I'm hoping that this touches the right people and we can take action. Are there any final words on your end that you think folks need to hear about this concept?
The last comment that you made, I think, is extremely powerful. I think that it's really important that Black Americans have a unified front in favor of reparations for it to be possible for us to have a successful national movement on behalf of reparations.
All right. So just like that, we're at the end of this episode of Black History Year. This podcast is produced by Push Black, the nation's largest nonprofit Black media company. You know, at Push Black, we agree with Marcus Garvey when he said, "A people without knowledge of their past history, origin, and culture is like a tree without roots." I'm guessing you probably feel like that's important too. I mean, you're here at the end of a podcast about Black history. You matter. Your choice to be here matters. It lets us know that you value the work. Push Black exists because we saw we had to take matters into our own hands. You make Push Black happen with your contributions at blackhistoryyear.com. Most people do about $5 or $10 a month, but everything makes a difference. Thanks for supporting the work. The Black History Year production team includes Tariq Alani, Patrick Sanders, William Anderson, Jerea Bradley, Brooke Brown, Shonda Buchanan, Escadar Getahoon, Leslie Taylor Grover, Abani Jones, Aquia Tay, Darren Wallace, and our producer, Sydney Smith. For Lemonade House, our producers are Jessica Rue France and Sasha Kai Parker, who also edits the podcast. Black History Year's executive producers are Julian Walker for Push Black and Michael Elsesser for Lemonade House. I'm Jay for Push Black. Thanks for checking us out. Peace.